I'm Highlight of visionexperts.com, and this would be what my brain would sound like if you would examine that by using audio waves. Anyways, the topic that I'm going to address over here today is a thing that's called audio envelopes and how they work internally. Audio envelopes can be pretty interesting from time to time, especially in the realm of, let's say, control voltage, if you will. The control voltage in this case is being manipulated by a thing like audio processing, if you will. If I take a drum, I will go for this, right there. Basic straight forward to the floor thing. The nice thing is that if I take a effect, like say a effect that's going to be a pulverizer demolition, right there. The pulverizer demolition already has a built-in audio listener and an audio follower embedded inside of this device, which is located right here. In theory, what will happen is if I trigger run right now, you will see that every time that the bass drum kind of kicks in, this thing starts to light up. That is happening because of two different things. First of all, it listens to like what is the incoming audio doing, how much spikes does it have, and when it reaches a specific thing that's called a threshold in, let's say, decibels, then all of a sudden this envelope follower will kick in. And when this happens, it sends out a CV signal, which is again from the rear. It is called the follower right there. The beauty behind this setup is that if you're going to create, like, let's say an audio effect, if you will, let's say an insert effect, or you're going to throw that inside of a combinator patch, which can later be used as an audio effect unit. The beauty behind these setups is that the effect itself will vary from everything that you're going to use as an audio source, because it listens to the incoming audio, and when the audio is changing, then the results will be a pretty much different thing. That's the beauty behind using audio followers in particular. So what I could do in this setup is create a effect that's going to be visually presentable. Let's go for, let's say, a crazy comb filter, if you will. I'm going to take a utility that's going to be a spider argument splitter right there. I'll take the output from here, from the insert effect, and stick that inside of the split section right here, because in this case I'm going to use the audio cable as being the listener right there inside of the pulverizer. The audio from the pulverizer is not going to be used, it's just going to be listening to what is happening with the audio. That's all it does. Then we'll take the audio output from here and stick that inside of, let's say, the input of the mixer 14.2. In this case, I'm going to split this whole thing up into multiple signals where I'm going to blend this through, let's say, a maelstrom, because a maelstrom can be used as an effect unit, if you will, using just the filter section only, which is done through here, audio input, and then it goes through, let's say, the filter frequency of, or the filter A and the filter B slot, where filter A is left, while filter B is right. So I will take the audio output from here and stick that inside of channel 2 right there. The beauty behind this setup is if I use this inside of an insert effect and I open up the programmer right there, I can stick in the follower inside of the CV input slot right there, making it bipolar in this case, so I have negative values and positive values, and use that to control, let's say, the maelstrom over here, and connect the CV input of the follower listener right there, and connect this to, let's say, the filter frequency. The filter frequency A and filter frequency B. If I press run right now, at this point it just sounds a little bit louder, just because I'm using the same signal twice and this thing is being cut off by a low pass filter. But the beauty is, every time that thing kicks in, you will see that this thing opens up. Let's take a different example. I will go for club kits, go for drum loops, and go for the first one. That's Afrobonic right there. That is Afrobonic right there. Press 1. All of a sudden I'm clipping, that's one thing. Let's just reduce the volume over. Press 1. At this point, you see that this whole thing is acting differently, because the audio has changed. The beauty behind the setup is that I can turn this into, let's say, a glitchy mess if I want to. Let's go for a comb filter. A comb filter is kind of like using a delay on top of a filter, if you will. But that is being controlled by a thing that's called resonance. The resonance basically determines like how much delay are you going to apply to that whole thing. So in this case, I'm just sweeping through the different frequencies of the comb filter. That makes it pretty hollow. I will wind this up using the spread knob right there and make it drunk. To add the drunk factor over here, I can change the values, the minimum value and the maximum value of these two comb filters, just to make it stereo-wise a little bit more effective in this case. So if I press run right now, I get a sound that goes like this. If I crank open the threshold right there, and I press run right now, you will notice that this change all of a sudden becomes less drastic. Because at some extent the threshold, in this particular case, if the threshold is all the way down, it makes it much more sensitive. If I'm going to increase the threshold, it means that it needs more audio before that follower actually kicks in. The signals just need to be louder at some extent. But this is partially the beauty behind using a follower, because I can also manipulate the way that the follower acts like. For instance, if I take a utility, that's going to be another spider audio merger splitter. I'm going to disconnect this original signal that I have, and I will call this one just the merge signal. I'm using an additional merger splitter just for visual presentation only. I know for a fact that I can also do that inside of the same thing over here. Anyways, the signal goes inside of this path right there, inside of the merge section right there. In this case, I can blend multiple signals and add them one by one. So I'm just making the signal louder at some extent. But because it's not audible, I can actually get away with it, like that. You stick that inside of the audio input right there. And now all of a sudden you will notice that this thing becomes pretty hot. Right there. All of a sudden this comb filter reacts in a whole different way. Another thing that I could do is manipulate the audio differently by using, for instance, let's say a compressor. A compressor has the tension over here to make the audio peak pretty high. At some extent, this is not control voltage manipulation that I'm doing, but eventually the result will be that I'm manipulating the control voltage. Because the thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to crank up the ratio pretty high, so the audio spikes pretty hard. Going to drop the threshold, increase the gain all the way open, like that. So at this point, the audio becomes rather sensitive and spiking pretty hard. But that goes in conjunction with that whole envelope follower right there. So that means that an envelope follower becomes much more sensitive than it was before. If I drop the input gain right there, you will notice that all of a sudden that envelope follower becomes lesser active. So what I'm just creating right now is a way to manipulate the CV input signals by increasing the input gain of, let's say, the incoming audio. There are alternatives if it comes to making an audio listener. Let's go for this route. I'm going to go for a combinator. And the combinator is going to be an effect unit. And in this case, I'm just going to go for a straightforward piano setup. I'm going to go for an NNXT right there. Stick the NNXT inside of this section right there. And I will go for a grand piano. Why not? We're going to make the drunk version of a piano. Right there. Sounds pretty nice, being a piano. What I'm going to take over here is an effect that's going to be a compressor. I'll press and hold shift, add the compressor right there. And the next thing that I'm going to take over here is a utility that's going to be an audio merger splitter. Because the thing that I want to achieve right now is to make an after effect after pressing a key. So I'm releasing the key, and at that point it should kind of like trigger an effect, more or less. To achieve that, I'm going to stick this inside of the split section right there. I just want to split this up into two different paths. Taking the dry signal right there, and then the wet signal, or the other signal right there, goes inside of the thing that's called the compressor. Right there. And the nice thing about the compressor is that I can also use this thing to manipulate, let's say, the CV outputs using this section right there. That's the gain reduction. And the gain reduction is nothing more than when I press a key right there and it listens to the audio, all of a sudden that signal becomes too hot and it just drops off the gain, and that becomes my CV signal that I can use through the gain reduction right there. Put that inside of CV input 1. And the next thing that I'm going to take over here is a digital delay while pressing and holding shift. Because normally if I add the delay right there, it will attach that thing to, let's say, the send effect. And that's something that I don't want. What I want to do over here is take the master out and stick it inside of the delay setup right there and connect the delay setup inside of the output from here. So it goes through the piano, or it goes through the mixer first, and then it goes through the delay, thus becoming a delayed signal. The thing that I want to achieve over here is muting the audio while that thing is kicking in. But at this point, it starts to become a little bit glitchy because every time that I press a key, it doesn't really matter what I'm going to do, it sets that thing to mute. That has everything to do with the fact that this thing is all of a sudden, by default, a bipolar setup. So I'm going to go for unipolar instead. That kind of solves this issue right here. What I'm just creating is a pretty weird artifact, more or less, because if I select a key over here, that thing goes on mute, but when I'm pressing and holding that key, that thing goes on unmute. That's exactly the behavior that I want to have, because I'm going to revert the changes over here. So if I press the key right there, it becomes rather unstable, as you can see right there. The next thing that I'll take is this delay setup, because what I'm going to do over here is connect this audio listener, if you will, and connect this to, let's say, the delay dry web balance settings over here as well. So this thing goes against the feedback, and that thing goes against the dry web balance of this digital delay. So in theory, what I just created over here is a pretty funky piano that does something pretty weird, because it's not like acting like a normal piano would do. Because if I press a key, you don't hear it. But when I keep and pressing and holding that key right there, all of a sudden that thing becomes audible. And that's kind of like the artifact that I'm going for right now, because it's going to be an aftertouch effect. But later on, I can also use this dry signal right there and stick that inside of channel 2 right there to create like a parallel thing. But that's just for later. Because the next thing that I'm going to do is turn this into a glitchy mesh by using the delay time on top of the CV input signal that I have. So in this case, this thing goes inside of milliseconds right there, and it kind of depends on how this thing flows. If you go from low to high, it makes it go pitch down. If you're going from high to low, it makes it pitch up. That's pitch down. Right there. And if I do it exact opposite way, right there, go from high to low like that, it makes it pitch up. I think this sounds drunk enough already. Almost like a flanger, if you will. In this case, I'm going to go for two times a digital delay setup where one goes left, the other one goes right. I'm going to throw all those signals combined together. In this case, I'm going to attach an additional line 6-2 mixer just to make sure that I can have full control on the output levels when I'm actually triggering a key. Right there. Because at some extent, I could also use this level knob right there to make it automatable by that CV signal that I have right there. So what I'm going to do next is take the CV input, take this against, let's say, the level of channel 1 right there. But in this case, the minimum value is going to be 100, which is the native state as it is right now. There, it's 100. But I'm going to drop off the volume just a nudge right there. Let's say 85. Somewhere around that area. So if I press a key right now, you will see that all of a sudden that level just starts to go down. Because I've added an additional delay right there, being the right signal, I want to achieve some effect, let's say stereo-wise effective, if you will, to make changes within this delay setup over left versus right. In this case, this thing goes from 30 to 1. I will do a similar thing, but just a little bit differently. So, CV input 1, CV input 1 right there, CV input 1 right there. This thing goes against the feedback, that thing goes against the dry web balance, and this thing goes against the milliseconds, but the changes are going to be almost 30, not entirely the same, and almost 1, not entirely the same, right there. That makes it pretty drunk at this point. So what we're just creating over here is drunk piano. Okay, this output goes inside of the channel 2 right there. So I'm creating a parallel unit at the same time. So I'm keeping the dry signal. But the beauty behind the setup is while it's now sounding like a broken piano, like this, it doesn't really matter what I'm going to do over here. Let's go for a guitar over here. Acoustic steel right there. In this case, I might make it a little bit more sensitive by increasing the input gain right there. Because the beauty behind this setup is that it just listens to the incoming audio, and that audio just determines like what is going to be the result of this whole setup. So eventually I could do the same thing, let's say an auxiliary over here, by adding an additional effect that's going to be a digital delay line. And while pressing a key, I can also open up the auxiliary right there. So let's just do that. I will go for line 6 to mixer. I will go for CV input 1. And I'm going to open up the send effect on auxiliary 1 right there. That makes a delay. That makes it a really funky guitar. Let's say I'm going to save this as an audio effect right there. I'm just going to save this as an audio effect unit because the beauty behind the setup is if I take a new rack right there, I can just reuse that same setup that you just created over here. Let's go for a instrument. Let's go for an instrument right there. Dr. Rex loop player. I will open up a drum right there. Go for something like that. Open up the insert effect. Say show programmer. Open up the browse section right there and go for my D drive. Where's my D drive? I have my audio effect right there. Just saved it. And it's the same exact combinator patch. Press 1. And all of a sudden I have a unique take on some original audio track that would sound totally differently compared to what it usually was. It's a pretty awesome technique, especially if you need a specific effect in a specific direction where it needs to listen to the incoming audio and that effect drives that into a specific direction when that audio reaches a specific volume. That's kind of like the beauty behind this setup. You could throw this against, let's say, delay setups. You could also apply this with reverb. You could also apply it with chorus flangers. You could do that with unisons, any effect that's out there, because everything can be controlled through here, through the programmer of, let's say, an insert effect or a combinator effect unit. That's all an option to do so. That's one of the reasons why I like to use it. Anyways, have lots of fun, and I will talk to you later.